a delay.
Alright. How does the set look? Oh, we're good there. Top of my head is cut off. Alright, light seems good. Man. I'm gonna wait for the clock to turn. Cause people might not be here yet. Oh, there's all this stuff popping up. Silly Facebook. So we're running about a 30-second delay from what goes into the camera to what I'm seeing here. And just to be aware, that happens with the chat. So, or that complicates the chat. If you're commenting on something as you're seeing it, there's a chance that I might be disconnected from what you're talking about. Welcome, everybody, to Martial Arts Radio Live. This is the third installment of this show coming to you live. Hence the live. The first Tuesday of every month, 8 p.m. Eastern, from somewhere in my house. Last couple months we were out in the warehouse, aka Whistlekick headquarters, but it is currently 38 degrees out there, so no, I am not recording from there. I decided to go the complete opposite and record in front of the stove. It is nice and toasty. My back will probably be sweating by the time we end this, but I wanted to do something that was a different set. You know, I do... It's funny, this entire house is just becoming like content based on different locations. Who would win tends to happen over there, and first cup is over there on the couch, and martial arts radio happens right there behind that wall. I'm not recording anything from the bathroom. You're weird for thinking it. And I know at least some of you were thinking it, you weirdos. Thanks for coming by. I enjoy doing the show. It gives me a chance to interact with people live here and see your comments and everything else. I'm going to open the show with this. This is a teaser. You think you know what this is. Some of you are going to guess as to what this is. And you might be right as to what it was, but what it is something very different. You're welcome to guess. I'm not going to confirm or deny, but I'm going to say that in the next month, you should know what this is. I want to give a shout out to Gabe Siu, who's been on the show, who helps coordinate the live episodes. And look, he gave me all this material. Like, look at all this stuff that I get to talk about. Like, I'm pumped. I'm pumped. I got three totally full pages here. And we're just going to keep evolving the show, figuring out new things that we can do, new ways to interact, and just... and make it fun. So if you have ideas, if you have things you want to see or do, I'm not going to be ridiculous, but yeah, feel free to jump in the chat and make comments. All right, so a quick recap from live episode 2, which you can dig back, you can find it on Facebook, you can find it on YouTube, you can find the audio in the Martial Arts Radio feed. We did a poll. We're probably not doing polls anymore, just because in order for you to deal with the poll, you had to kind of leave the video or open another window on a computer and just, it's an idea I still want to do, but we're going to have to find a different way to do it. Maybe we'll do them ahead of time. Dave and I were talking about that. So the poll last time was, what was the first martial arts book a new student should read? We've got some great suggestions here. Andrew says, Zen and the Martial Arts by Joe Hyams. Stacy says, It's a Lot Like Dancing by Ricky Moss. Tommy says, Complete Idiot's Guide to Martial Arts is not a bad start. And Craig says, The 20 Guiding Principles of Karate, The Spiritual Legacy of the Master by Gichin Funakoshi. Great choices. I have read two of them. I've read Joe Hyams' book, and I've read Funakoshi's book. So I can't really say. I mean, there's a new book that's coming out that might be appropriate. We didn't plan this. And I'll share that with you, that the Martial Artist Handbook is available for pre-order in Kindle format on Amazon. If you go to Amazon and search for Martial Artist Handbook, or if you search for my name, because I'm the author, so it'll find that. The paperback should be available for pre-order, I'm hoping. Is there anything wood around here? No. Knock on something that is wood, theoretically, should be available by the end of the week. So, it's almost fine. It's almost ready. I've been working on this book for a while. And just since she's in the chat, I'm going to shout out Jenny. Is she in the chat? I think I saw her in there. I don't remember. Jenny, if you're here, thanks for all of your help with the book. And to those of you helping with the editing right now, I appreciate you. All right. Well, welcome. Welcome. And last time, if anybody remembered, I was wearing a hood up because it was cold. And I was getting a lot of, catching some heck for that. With the hood up, we should call you the Punisher. More like Demon Hunter. Jeremy, the Diablo Assassin. Anyone else thinks Jeremy looks like a Whistlekick Jedi? Good times. Good times. Here's a bit of trivia. I'm not going to run this a little bit differently. So, it's in here as suggested trivia, but I keep using this analogy. The idea that martial artists quite often are like a bucket of crabs. And in the last month, I think I've brought that up like 3 or 4 times in different conversations, primarily around martial arts, and it's still the best analogy I know of. And the idea, if you ever have a bucket of crabs, you really don't have to worry about them getting out, because the moment one of them's about to climb out, the others will pull them back in. And we need to stop doing that to each other. Now, most of what we've been doing with the live episodes has been around Q&A. It's the way that I get to interact with all of you. And we got questions. If you ask questions in the chat, I will answer them. If you have questions you want for next time, put them in the Facebook event. But here are some questions that I'm going to dig into, and we can talk about them. This one's from Andrew. Should there be a teaching requirement for any gradings? Meaning, in order to pass this test, you have to have taught X number of classes first. Interesting. Interesting idea. Excuse me. I finished dinner like 8 minutes ago. So I'm burping. On the surface, this seems like a great idea. The idea of requiring instruction in order to be promoted to advance in rank in martial arts. Because anyone who has spent time teaching knows that it's two things. One, you're giving back. Martial arts doesn't continue to exist without people teaching it. And two, you learn a lot teaching. In fact, I would argue that most people, if they start their own martial arts school, are going to learn far more in that role as instructor than they ever would as student, because it forces you to adapt to the way different people learn. And if you know how to teach something in 7 different ways, you're going to understand it far better than if you do it one way. Gabe is saying, Amazon says the Kindle version of the book will be released on December 13th. That is correct. However, only if I upload the digital copy to Amazon by the 9th. So we're on track for that. Knock on wood. That's what my Friday is intended to be. I like people teaching. I like when people teach martial arts. I think it's important. I think it's transformational for some people. But what I've noticed, the moment anything is required to be done numerically with regard to testing, you have to run a mile in this time. Actually, a better example is you have to do this number of push-ups. Go to a test where people have to do a certain number of push-ups. Tell me how good the push-ups are. The moment we start encouraging quality over quantity, I think there's something really wrong. It doesn't work. Martial arts is not about quantity. It's about quality. What I would rather see, instead of you have to teach X number of classes, you have to teach a class where you are able to convey new information or old information in a new way, or just something. Something where maybe you get a 15-minute block in class, and if you screw it up, well, you get to try it again next time. Everything else we do in martial arts is based on incremental progress and the idea that getting something wrong is temporary. You have the opportunity to do it again. I don't like this number of classes stuff for that reason. Let's see if anybody agrees or disagrees. You know, we're talking about the book. We're lost about the book. If you're in the chat, you can see there's a direct link to the book. Hi, Stacy. Yeah. All right. We do have some people chiming in on this in the comments I have. Gabe says, that's an interesting thought. In our school, we have the requirement at brown belt and above that you understand the material well enough to be able to teach it. Not everyone wants to teach, but of course you learn it better when you do. And that's more in line with how I feel. I do believe everyone should be required to teach at some point. I think it's inevitable that if you remain in martial arts, you're going to teach. And that might not be being at the front of the class. But I feel strongly that a diverse martial artist is a better martial artist. And not just in the things that you know, but the things that you do, and how you do them, why you do them, etc. So teaching adds diversity, right? The ability to move from within the class to the front of the class, or part of the class, or take one person over in the corner and teach them something, I think that's pretty important. So I think I'm going to put it under the heading of everyone needs to do it, but how that's actually implemented, I think is completely flexible. Craig's in the chat saying, I agree, teaching quality is much more important than quantity, and that's coming from someone who teaches martial arts professionally as a full-time job and does a great job at it. So. Laura says, it's a bit of an unwritten rule that adults testing for black belt have experience teaching. Teen black belts are expected to run warm-ups on occasion and help lower-ranking students. You learn best by teaching others. And there's the common thread, right? There's almost this selfish aspect to teaching once you acknowledge that, hey, you're going to get better at it. It's difficult and it's uncomfortable. And here's the thing. I see a lot of martial artists who get towards black belt and they've never taught anything. They've been students perpetually. Well, here's the problem with that. The longer you remain a student, the harder it will be for you to make the transition into teaching, because you're going to apply much harsher judgment. I've been training martial arts for 10 years and I don't know how to teach a punch. Well, what if you're a yellow belt and you've been in class 2 months and then you show somebody else how to punch? The moment you look at any writing on education and teaching something, one of the ways that you get people to truly understand something is to teach it to someone else. Whether they're teaching it back to you or they're teaching it to someone that doesn't know it, if you can teach it, it shows an understanding on a much deeper level. And I've witnessed schools where teaching happens, you know, basically class two. If you were there last time and you know how to do this thing, show that person how to do it. Now, here's the problem. People complain about that. Not so much the students, but people watching and say, well, that person doesn't know how to do it. Well, they just started. Exactly. But they're on a road to progress, and so is that other person. You don't have to be an expert to teach something. And you don't have to be a genius to learn from someone who isn't an expert. I would guarantee every one of you watching right now could teach me something about martial arts, whether you've been training for 6 months or 6 years. And I look forward to that. I like that. I like working with new people for that reason. So teaching, yes, do it. It's important, but do it in a way that works at your school. Hi, Eric. Craig also says, oftentimes in our dojo, students will assist individual students with material, but they need to learn how to instruct and inspire to lead classes. Makes sense. And that's what works there. The style, the physical space constraints, the number of students, rank and age distribution all affect what makes sense for teaching. Okay. Next. Have you ever carved a turkey or ham with a sword or used a weapon for non-martial arts purposes? Just asking, don't blame me if something goes wrong, but make sure to record it if you do. So that was a question that was posted in a discussion leading up to this event tonight. And my comment was, does opening canned pineapple count? Now, I said that kind of facetiously because I've used martial arts weapons for a lot of ridiculous things. Opening letters. I've never opened pineapple. Andrew says, I used to cut watermelons when I was younger. Awesome. I think that's a great idea. I should get some watermelon and cut it. See, this is fun stuff. You know what, Gabe, take note. That's the kind of ridiculous but can still make it work stuff that we can do when it's summer. Because we'll do the show outside. Well, at least in the garage. And I'll chop watermelon. I'll be like Gallagher, put goggles on, hack away with a sword. Good times. I've never led a Taekwondo class, not at my rank, but learning how to teach and inspire recorded my success as a Zumba chair fitness instructor. Totally. Teaching is one thing. Inspiring someone is the goal of teaching. Oh, I like that. Very poignant, very powerful. I would love to know if you've done something ridiculous with martial arts weapons outside of hurting yourself. I don't want to hear about that. I don't want to hear about you hurting yourself or cutting off your thumb or, I don't know, something else ridiculous. But if you got something, let's hear it. Okay. What is it that gets you really excited when you get to class and you find out you're working on something? What is it that you, when you find out what you're doing, you're really excited? And Gabe used a gift from Napoleon Dynamite, Kip Gilling.
Yes.
It's a great movie. If you've never seen Napoleon Dynamite, it does have a martial arts scene in it. Andrew says kata. Alex says a new form. Jamie says endurance as I get older. Gabe responds, I hate running and endurance work, but I find it a bit easier when I'm doing something I enjoy. So, I do a lot of continuous sparring. Yeah, good call. Flexibility. I'm not naturally flexible, but training in the martial arts has helped me tremendously. Getting flexibility not only helps me kick people in the head, winky face, but also with my job when I need to climb or step over something. Anyone else experience a non-martial art benefit from training in the martial arts? Daniel says, I was running an off-road race last winter and saw a guy a few meters in front of me trip over something. He barely even seemed to break stride as he hit the ground with a perfect rolling brake fall and popped back up and kept running. Now that's impressive. That's something I would like to see. I don't think I've ever done anything like that. I've done some obstacle course races, but there's really little opportunity for dive rolls. Dive rolls are fun. I enjoy that. I don't know that it'll ever happen, so I'll share this idea that I had years ago. I started to look into it, and it just proved to be way too complex. Imagine an obstacle course race that is martial arts themed. So for those of you not familiar with the term obstacle course race, something like a Spartan race or a Tough Mudder, that's an obstacle course race, where you're running, but there are obstacles, there are things beyond simply just running. You have to perform actions. And what if you're doing that with a martial arts flavor? It gets kind of fun. You could have people throwing Nerf things at you. There can be stuff to jump over, stuff to avoid, crawl. If you think about all of the skills that we use in martial arts, we use a lot of stuff. And I think a martial arts themed race would be a lot of fun. The word that I wanted to use as I was coming up with names was around Warrior, but there is one called Warrior Dash. I don't know if it's still in the system. But I still think that would be fun. If somebody else wants to take the helm on that, take that idea, run with it, I'll be there. I'll come do it. It'd be tons of fun. Nothing longer than a 5K, though. I don't like running that far. No 10-mile things. I have friends that do longer Spartan races. People may not know. Spartan Race is based in Vermont. And it's based near Killington. And Joe DeSena, who started Spartan Race, renovated this I don't know if it was a hotel or just like an old farm before that, but it's absolutely beautiful. People get married there all the time. It's gorgeous. It's about 45 minutes from where I live. And the Death Race, which I don't know if that's still going on. It's kind of quiet. He ran that at his mountain that he lives on, and I had a couple friends that did the Death Race, and it's utterly insane. And, you know, 24 hours or first, you know, last person to quit kind of a thing. But the Spartan Race has, I think there's a race now where you do the long one twice, which would be something like 50 miles. 50 miles of running with obstacles. That's too many miles. I like the obstacles. The obstacle stuff's fun. I've done a number of those. But yeah, 5K is where my knees remain happy. How related are parkour and martial arts? Good question. One of the quotes that I'm fond of saying and has been kind of memeified and shared around is there are only so many ways to move. There's only so many ways that the human body can move, and only so many of those make sense from the perspective of combat, right? That's martial arts. Just because my arm can do this, that doesn't mean that it's good. Why did that hurt? Doesn't mean that would be martial arts related. So you've got the entirety of human movement, combat-related things are martial arts. You've got parkour, which is efficient motion. Okay, I forget what the term translates as. It's a French word, as you might have guessed. But if someone is doing parkour versus free running is when people are doing crazy excessive things and flips and whatnot. But parkour, by nature, is... I did a few years of parkour. And actually, is Andrew still in the chat? My parkour instructor was in here at one point. Andrew, I don't know if you're still there, man. He is. Hey. That's fun. It's about how to get from point A to B as efficiently as possible. And that's where the vaults and these very fluid, interesting, you know, hands as you're going over objects and sliding under and moving around. There's a lot there. Because as you get better at martial arts or parkour or any other movement discipline, you get efficient at it, or you aim to become more efficient. If you're sparring, you're not trying to waste motion. That's something that you do as a white belt. As you get better, there's less wasted motion. Parkour, there's less wasted motion. So I think that's probably the best way to compare the two. I've done a couple sessions of parkour for martial artists focused around balance and the skill that we practice the least that I think comes into play in parkour, which is safely descending. You know, we're good at jumping up and down. You know, we start up on a surface, we land on that surface. Most people instinctively can handle jumping up onto something. But the moment you have to jump down, that becomes a big deal. That becomes much harder to do, to use muscle and balance to slow yourself safely. And that's actually something that happens often. Maybe not in the sense of combat, But a lot of people that I know that do martial arts only do martial arts, so we want to make sure that we have all notions of physical movement involved. I like having people do martial arts sitting in chairs. I like having them sit on the floor, lay on the floor. People rarely come up to you and attack you when you're in a fighting stance and you're ready to go and warmed up, right? There's going to be some kind of compromise. They're looking for the advantage. That's why they're doing it. Bullies and criminals look for opportunity. They don't go after, you know, the 6'4", 250-pound, strong-looking guy who's, you know, carrying a sledgehammer. That would be silly. Andrew is commenting, efficiency and fluidity. That's a great word. Fluidity are key to parkour. And I think there was a joke. Frank had a joke in here. Here it is. Hold on. Come back. Come back. For those of you who don't know Frank, Frank is the producer on First Cup and drops a joke in every Friday. He's giving us a bonus joke. Two silkworms got into a race. How did it end? In a tie. I love Frank's jokes. So, yeah. If you've not done any parkour or free running or whatever you want to call it, it's a great thing to learn. And this idea that, you know, it's only for kids or you've got to be 20 to do it or something, it's just not true. And if you want a more adult-accepted way to start, start with rock climbing. It's going to challenge your body in ways that martial arts does not, because we are hanging, and that's something that you don't do too much of in martial arts. I don't think I've ever had a class where I've hung off something. I've hung off people when I was younger and smaller in self-defense situations gone wrong. Thinking of a guy named Dave, he was about 6'3", and probably 260. My 75-pound frame is not enough to pull him down. But as you get better at that, at being able to hold and move around, you're probably going to feel more confident. And gyms are popping up all over the place that have that kind of American warrior feel. And grab a couple kids. Grab a couple 11 or 12-year-old boys. Probably girls, too. Grab a couple, like, adolescent children. Take them to the gym with you. They'll teach you. Because again, everybody has something to teach and everybody has the opportunity to learn. It's just a question of whether or not you're willing to. All right, moving on. Good question. Give me another one like that. Mats. Should we train on them for comfort and safety or not to condition our feet? Stacy says, yes, mats, to preserve what's left of my ankles. And Gabe responds, indeed, ankles are only slightly important to the martial arts. And we discussed this in one of the Facebook groups. Safety first. Matt says, I've done both. I like the hard floor for black belts or senior ranks, but I think mats are better for beginners. Mats are better for throws. BJJ, we used mats, but when a tournament was approaching, they pull up the mats, so we get to use a hard floor. Ron says, it depends on what you're training for to start with, and if you were in a martial art that is competition-based, then yes, if you train for self-defense, then you should regularly train in normal clothing and in a normal environment, parks, cars, etc. All right, so here's my thought on mats. They have value, but as Ron is getting to, they should not be the only environment that you train in. If the only time you train is on mats, and you become used to mats, the moment you get off mats, it's different. I've seen people who are used to training solely on hardwood get into competition, and they fall doing their form because they ended up in a competition that had matted rings. I don't think I've seen the opposite, but I've definitely seen people who are used to training on mats with, you know, the way they move in their sparring go into a hardwood situation, and it's so different that they're not quite sure what to do. Let's turn that back up. Managing the stove while I talk. I'm not a fan of mats most of the time. I I like being grounded. I like having my feet on the floor or in the dirt or on the pavement. Yes, I will train on pavement. I'd rather not be doing rolls on pavement. I'd rather not be sparring on pavement. But if that's what I gotta do, it's what I gotta do. And because of that, I feel confident that I've trained in enough different environments that those are not going to be a hindrance to me. The idea of training in, quote unquote, normal clothing, with and without shoes. I love being barefoot, but most of the time when I'm out in the world, I'm wearing shoes. If I never train wearing shoes, it changes things. There are benefits to wearing shoes in a combat self-defense situation. There are disadvantages. Understanding what those are, it matters. It's real. It's something that we should do. Did the rise of XMA help the popularity of parkour? I don't think so. I feel like XMA, I feel like the heyday, it kind of started to fall off as parkour was becoming more popular. I'm not 100% sure why parkour started getting bigger. I think, just from my observation, a lot of it came from the video game Assassin's Creed, because that's the way the main character moved. Maybe somebody else has an opinion there. Sparring on hardwood brings me back to my color belt days. Jenny says, exactly, you never know what situation you'll be in when you need your martial arts. Bring it back to this, what I said before. A diverse martial artist is a better martial artist. So train with diversity. If you're an instructor and you only have mats, if it's really hard to pull them up, maybe you can take everybody outside. Maybe you can rent a high school gym for an hour. Give people the opportunity to train in different ways. Bright lights, low light. I've done episodes on this. There's an episode of Martial Arts Radio, maybe somebody can find it, where we talk about different training environments and why that's important. I don't want to beat that horse too much since there is an episode on it, but let's get the number so you all can check that out at another time. Other things we can talk about. Have I worked with military combat arts or systems? What are some of the differences and the similarities? What should all civilian martial artists know about military combat arts? I think that part's easy. When you look at militarized martial arts systems like the Marine Corps' MCMAP, Marine Corps Martial Arts Program, I think that's the abbreviation, it's simpler. There's a lot less to know. And it's meant to be a well-rounded system to address a variety of situations. And there's an elegance in that simplicity. And I like that. Krav Maga, when it first was taught, but at some point along the way, when Krav Maga was taught to the Israeli military, they had 6 weeks. How would you teach martial arts if you had 6 weeks with someone? I'm assuming that's not 8 hours a day, 7 days a week for 6 weeks. I'm assuming that's a few hours a day. I don't know. I wasn't in the Israeli military. But I'm going to guess 2 to 3 hours a day. Because really, you can't get a whole lot more new material down somebody's throat into their brain than 2 or 3 hours a day. So you gotta make sure that you're hitting the high points, the best bang for the buck. You're not teaching them 47 different versions of a punch. Now my experience with military combat, it's Americanized Krav Maga. It's Krav Maga that's been brought over here, and I have no idea how true it is to what was first taught or is currently taught in Israel. But it makes sense. The concepts make sense for me. It's a lot of elbows and knees and very simple things there. I think the other one that warrants mention is Tony Blauer's spear system, which, while what I've learned of it in the one seminar I took with Tony, it was certainly not targeted at military people. I don't think there were any military people in the room. It was a CrossFit seminar. There was a crossover for a period of time. I don't think that still exists, where Tony Blauer was teaching spear to CrossFit people, and I went as far as my continuing ed in CrossFit. But it's great. You know, it's a great system. It's something that you can, in a day, give people some really basic stuff. Of course, they have to work on it. They have to train to ingrain it. But the concepts are simplified enough. And that's probably the biggest difference. When you teach someone a military combative system, you're teaching them how to stay alive moment one. Everything is from that concept. When we teach someone karate or taekwondo, the first time they walk in, at least in none of the schools I've ever trained in, is it about staying alive from moment one. It's about personal development. It's about growth. Most people aren't interested in spending the next 20 years of their lives training self-defense. But plenty of people will spend 20 years getting better at life through martial arts. That's why I love it. Hold on, we got questions. What about fantasy-based martial arts? Rather, martial arts that are not tested in reality for whatever the reason may be. I think this can be a real disservice for adults looking for actual self-defense. Here's my thought. The vast majority of movements taught in martial arts will work in self-defense under specific circumstances. Most martial artists have not been in a fight. At least not. I retract that sentence. Most martial artists have not been in a lot of fights to the point where they fully understand self-defense. I'm one of them. I'm not embarrassed to say that. My martial arts kept me out of fights. I'm really proud of that. I'm not the best person to teach you how to win a fight, but I'm a great person to teach you how to not get into one. And I think that that is a valid skill. It's only if those skills break down that you actually need to physically defend yourself. It's true, we have a lot of people in martial arts who are theoretically qualified to teach self-defense, but do not have the practical experience to fully convey the information. And that can be a disservice, yes. However, on the flip side, if I give you this pen cap, and I tell you keeping this magic pen cap in your pocket will keep people from attacking you, it is a lie. It's an outright lie. But the irony of that statement is that if you believe it, you are going to carry yourself more confidently. That confidence makes you less of a target. So, while the crummy self-defense that some people, some schools teach is fraudulent, yes, it still has the impact of keeping people out of fights. So even accidentally, martial arts is better. Eric, are you raising your hand? Because that's weird. We got some other things that came through here. Wow, all right. Going back. Does your training change with the seasons? I mean, there's 6 inches of snow out back. I'm not training barefoot out in the backyard. It's cold outside. I'm not training out in the backyard. And I think that's probably the biggest difference. You know, here in New England, we run outdoor stuff June, July, August, September. Other than that, it's pretty much guaranteed to be inside. Once in a while, if you have a school that also has, you know, an adjoining lawn or certain, you know, flat surface, you can go outside. Some schools might do that, you know, on a nice May day or October day, but for the most part, you're inside. Gabe and Jenny, we train at a church with a grassy hill that we use for kata and self-defense. Cool. Andrew says, survive and then win. Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. This will come up if you listen. This is going to be episode like 360, a guest that I interviewed today. Phenomenal guest. I had a great time talking to her. She's talking about how she was taught, first you run, and only if you can't run do you defend yourself, and the impact that had on her as a young child. Survival is the most important part. It is ingrained in us. Different training environments. That episode I mentioned was episode 113. Wow, we're going back. Definitely going back. Liz is saying, yes, I agree. Confidence makes you less of a target. Undoubtedly. What's the weirdest thing someone has asked? What's the weirdest thing someone has asked you to do because you're a martial artist? Well, we got all the cliches, right? And I want to hear from those of you in the chat what people have asked you to do. You've got the noises, show me a move. Can you break this? Can you kick that person in the head? And when I was younger, I would indulge some of these things. You know, not that I'm kicking someone in the head hard, but just, you know, to bring my foot up and close. You know, I've broken boards. But what I've learned is most of the time, people are looking for you to mess up or something. That martial arts occupies this really strange place in the world, in that it's something most people recognize the value of. But most people are not going to invest the time to do it. So they look for ways to belittle it because it justifies, in their mind, not investing the time to do it. Hey, fire's back up. Here, I'll move this way. You guys, I don't know if anybody wants to see the fire. And once I connected those dots and I realized, hey, I'm not doing anybody anything, any good, by indulging these requests, I just stopped doing it. Oh, the bottle cap challenge, I like that. Laura says, how many surface pros can you destroy with one strike? Laura, that would be a great but expensive question. Laura and Stacy, who are both in the chat, are the whistle kick breaking team, Team Smashy Smash. And I forget what Laura's up to on, is it palm, heel, elbow? Maybe it's stomp. One of her breaks is just some ridiculous number of boards, so I can only imagine stacking up a bunch of computers to break. I mostly get asked, this is from Alessi, I mostly get asked, do you think you could beat so-and-so in a fight? I always say no to that question now. Asked to steal something because I knew karate and could beat someone up if they tried to stop me. that's crazy town. Laura says 10 or 11 surface pros. And I know people get asked to do even crazier things, and it's just ridiculous what people ask others to do. And I think the best way to handle that, and I'm going to credit my first karate instructors with this one. If somebody really wants to see some martial arts, bring them to class. Come try a class. Come watch class. It's fun. You meet good people. You meet good people, great people. I have a note, it's meant to be funny, and I guess it is, but at the same time, it's kind of insightful. Sparring is just mutually agreed upon assault. mean, the word assault is kind of aggressive, but yeah, if we did any of the things that we do sparring to someone on the street, it would be considered assault. So I kind of like that idea. Care to explain my no answer? So I think that's, see, this is the pain of the delay. I think that's going back to, can I beat so-and-so in a fight? I would say no, because what happens when you say yes? There is a significantly greater chance that it escalates when you say yes. If I'm hanging out with a group of people and we're talking and they find out that I do martial arts, and somebody points to the biggest person in the group and says, could you beat that person up? I say, no. Well, why not? You're a big, tough martial artist. I never said I was tough. It's something I've done for a long time. And most of the things that I've practiced have very little to do with being in a fight. I've managed to talk my way out of every altercation that I've ever been presented with, and I really have no interest in being a fighter. And then I change the subject. If I have to, if they're not letting it go, I just say, look, I'm short. That person's a lot bigger than me. There's a reason weight classes exist in most combat disciplines. What do you want from me? You know, just something like that. Matt says, have you ever done full contact sparring in a tournament? No, because I do not enjoy getting hit. I've definitely been hit, probably not full contact, but I've definitely been hit hard enough to know I don't like it. Yeah, Liz is saying they think you're cocky, and it turns into a prove it situation, and nobody wins in that. Here's a scenario, this is a good one. You've just started working out, maybe a training session, you realize that you just don't have it today. You're not going to have a good workout. What do? How do you respond? When I was younger, and that happened, I would just count the seconds to be done and just go home.
Ooh, pardon me.
But I look at it differently now. And maybe that's because I'm older, and it is rare that I'm going to get to class on time, well rested, having eaten properly, well hydrated. My body feels great. I've got the right uniform on. The people that I really want to train with are in class. Flexibility is good. The room's not too hot, not too cold, etc., right? So if you think about all these factors that contribute to your training, what's the chance that they're all going to line up at the same time? Pretty slim. So it becomes about not having the best workout ever, but the best workout you can under the circumstances. Oh, I missed the biggest one. Your mindset, your head strength. That's the one that gets me the most. What's the best workout I can have with these circumstances, with these people, with my body feeling the way it is, with my head where it's at? Sometimes after a difficult day, if I go to train, my goal is to simply not think about the difficulties. And guess what? I do, but I try not to do it too much. And I try to be kind to myself and give myself space to get what I can out of it. Because here's the thing. A terrible workout is better than no workout. In all but a few weird exceptions, like, oh, you broke your leg. Yeah, it would have been better to stay home. Do what you can with what you have, where you're at. That applies to every aspect of life, including your martial arts training. Ah, Frank says the same thing. A little bit of something is better than a whole lot of nothing. But let's continue this. for a moment. There are things you can do to set yourself up for success. When I go to Taekwondo, our changing room is a bathroom. I go in the bathroom, put on my dobok, and I close my eyes, and I count to 10. And it's a really quick meditation. But during that count, I let go of everything from the day, as best I can, and get ready for the chaos that's going to ensue in moments as the children start to arrive for the kids' class. And that helps. And if nothing else, I try to find a way to have fun. There's always a way to have fun. If you're not having fun, you're not being creative enough. And I don't just mean as an instructor. It can be as a student. Practice visualizing. You're doing step punch up and down the floor. How ridiculous of a cartoon character can you deform by punching them repeatedly? Well, that punch, I knocked his chest in, and now his heart's sticking out the other side of his body, and now he's completely deformed and looks like he's got a mouth in, right? Just find ways to work with what you have. Liz says, if you're always looking for a Goldilocks training day, you'll never show up. Yes. Laura says, if you're getting sick, go home. Otherwise, go train. Consistency is the most important thing in anything you're looking to do. If you want to progress, you have to be consistent. And that means sometimes not getting worse by not practicing is the best you can do. Sometimes it's about stopping the bleeding, the degradation of your skills, or rather slowing them down. If sitting on the couch means you're going to deteriorate at a sharp rate, and having bad workouts means you deteriorate at less, you should be going to class. There's always something to be gained from training. Where did board breaking come from? Why do we do it? Pros and cons. I don't know where it came from. We do it for a couple reasons. One, it's fun. Breaking things is fun. Who doesn't like to break things? That by to use your body to destroy what we generally perceive as a very durable object, that's super cool. The other reason we do it. This is probably going to blow your mind, but let's follow it up. What are the surfaces that we teach people to punch? Generally, solar plexus and the face. With the exception of the nose, the eyes, maybe the teeth. The head is really hard. You could take some pretty significant chunks of wood and break it over somebody's head. The head is stronger than the wood. If you're not comfortable punching through a few boards, don't expect to be able to not break your hand punching somebody in the skull when you need it. I think that's where the value of breaking is to condition your body, but also your mind to know what to expect when you're hitting something hard. Jenny says she loves breaking things. Laura says it's fun. It is fun. One of the sayings, something I've heard along the way. I don't know how much I agree with it, but you use a hard surface on a soft target, like, say, the arm. You use a soft surface, like an open hand, on a hard target, like a head. I think I like that, but I haven't played it out well enough. I haven't spent any time with it. If I'm teaching self-defense to people who don't know anything about martial arts, if I'm teaching them to go to the head, yeah, it's an open hand. Because I can teach someone to do this much easier than I can teach them to make a fist and hit properly and not, catch the wrong knuckles. Something to think about. If the martial arts were developed today, what would the weapons look like? Pool cues? Shovels? Hammers? Shout out to Guru Chris Thompson, who developed a system around a hammer based in principles of Filipino martial arts. He's an awesome practitioner, nice guy. I haven't seen him in ages. I gotta make time to see that guy. But his hammer system is super cool. And I believe he's the first person to develop something like that. What else do we have? Knives. It's about stuff you have laying around, right? Shovel. Some kind of a stick thing, you know, like I got tripods and scissors. Scissors would make for an interesting weapon. I'm gonna do a scissor form at the next tournament. Just spin them and open them. And cut people's hair. Tell us about your consulting business. I don't really want to get into that because it's not really martial arts related. I mean, I'm available and I'm doing some work with some martial arts people in schools. But I do business in marketing consulting for the sole purpose of putting money back into Whistlekick and helping Whistlekick grow. And if you want to learn more about the coaching and consulting stuff, you can go to whistlekick.com. There's some links in there you can check out. Selfie sticks. There was a... where was that? This goes back a few years. I think we even mentioned it on like the first or the second roundup episode, which is what the Thursday episodes originally were, about a Russian school teaching self-defense with selfie sticks. It was like episode 37 or 9 or 41, somewhere in there, like way far ago. But here's the thing about selfie sticks. They're all flimsy junk. I mean, I wouldn't want to get hit with one, but thanks. This is a great one to end on. If you could tell every school owner or master one thing, what would it be? You're the example. If you want your students to train hard, are you training hard? If you want your students to be kind, are you being kind? If you want them to care about their training, do you care about their training and your training? Just as children grow to be like their parents, martial arts students grow to be like their instructors. And if you're not happy with your students, it's probably your fault. If you look around the room and think, why can nobody get this? Well, you're not teaching it well. And that's okay. It's okay to not be great at something all the time. It's okay to admit, as a martial arts instructor, that there are aspects of your skill that are better than others. Maybe you have someone in the class who does certain things better than you. Maybe it's a higher rank. Do you know how powerful it is to bring that person up and say, you know what? So-and-so does this better than I do. I want them to show you. That does a wonder for that person. It shows your students that you're aware of what's going on. Because guess what? They know that person already does it better than you. Gives the other students something to aspire to. It's just a better overall environment. For too long, we have acted like martial arts instructors are these untouchable, infallible people. And it's just not true. And I am excited for what happens when the current older generation of martial artists is no longer in position to spread that crud. I don't want anybody to die, but inevitably they're going to die. And while we're going to lose some things, that's one thing I'm excited to lose. There are, the chat is turning into a discussion on selfie stick defense. You're welcome to jump in and check that out. So, this was good. This was good. Good amount of content, Gabe. I think we had good stuff. I like the topic questions. This is my favorite stuff. But here's the thing. I want to know what you think. I want to know what you want me to talk about. What do you want to see? You know, the benefit to this medium is that you can see me. You can see me gesticulating wildly. You can see my facial expressions. But we can also do more of a show and tell. I need a little bit of prep work on that. You know, I gave you this. What is this about? Right? What is this about? This super heavy. Man, that's heavy. You know what this was? This is not what it is, but what it was. This was a grand champion medal from the tournament that we held coming up on, you know, it was 3.5 years ago. Each one of these was like $30 because they're heavy. If I put this on a chain, I could kill people with it easily. I don't trust that the jump rings on this and the flimsy ribbon would actually would hold if I swung this. But I mean, this weighs, it's over a pound. There were people at the tournament that were posting pictures. They'd taken 3, 4, 5 medals, and you could see their heads just craned forward. It was great. Thank you. Thank you for coming by. Thanks for watching. Thanks for asking questions. Thanks for submitting feedback. Let's grow this. Let's keep having fun with it. So I hope you all have a great night. If you want to join me for First Cup tomorrow, 6:30 a.m. Eastern on YouTube. Send it out. Until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day. Take care, everybody.